Yep, sorry. All right. Now, going back, let's hold on a second. So, going back, day 24, labor cost control. You know, review every business should have, labor, obviously. But it should be around 25 to 30% of the sales. You need to hire the right people, and you need to train them properly. If not, you're going to lose them. And we talked about retention and how to keep your employees and how to keep that retention. And we talked about that retention a few weeks ago, but very important retention and training. Very, very important. Cross training, also very important. Making sure that everybody knows what's going on in the whole environment, the whole restaurant itself. You want to promote a healthy culture, a healthy environment, an environment that's not a toxic environment. Toxic environments create issues and create problems, and all that's going to do is just make your life living hell as a manager if you have a culture, a horrible culture, or a bad environment in there. You want to avoid extra overtime, extra. Like, for example, like OT or anything like that. If you're doing a lot of OT, well, let's hire a part-time person, or let's hire someone so where I'm not selling or I'm sorry, we're not giving a bunch of OT away just because of it gets very pricey. If you will. Let's see. To calculate labor cost, for labor cost, it's labor cost divided by total sales and then times 100. And that gives you that labor percent. And we saw that. I think we talked about that yesterday. And the video, I think he talked about that in the video of calculating labor cost. And talking about labor cost. Let's see. You also have some fixed variable costs. What are some fixed variable costs? Anybody? Or fixed labor costs? What is a
Things
fixed
you
labor
always know you're
cost?
gonna have to pay.
Exactly. You always know you gotta pay that. And you also have you have salary, you have part-time, you have full-time, you have part-time 20, you have all sorts of different variables, different costs that you're gonna have to do, but a fixed cost is not gonna ever change. That's your kind of your salaried employees, your employees that are gonna be constant, all the time. And now hourly employees can be a constant all the time, but the problem is overtime, right? So overtime is one of those things you gotta be very careful with. And we had kind of talked about that yesterday. Let's see. Calculating labor cost. Someone read this one. Boom.
Calculating restaurant costs is a critical part of your job, but it does not have to be difficult or time-consuming. It is also worth the effort because when you know what your costs are, you can measure them against sales and get a good idea of how your restaurant is faring. You can then use that information to quickly pinpoint areas of improvement in your restaurant operations.
Really nothing really to discuss there. That's pretty straightforward. Let's see, calculating a prime cause. Okay, so Heidi, do you mind reading this?
As you know, the two biggest expenses for restaurants are prime costs, or the combined costs of food / beverage and labor. Prime costs should not equal more than 55 to 60% of weekly sales, with labor costs being 15 to 17% of total weekly sales. It is simple to determine labor costs after the shift, but what is the best way to plan proper shift coverage and future labor costs? If you are not using a predictive scheduling software, the next best option is to do a little math before preparing your schedule.
All right, so thank you, I appreciate it. So scheduling is so important. Who's had to deal with scheduling before? Anybody?
I have.
Okay, Marilyn, you know, if you schedule things wrong or not properly weighted, it can really mess you up, right?
Yes, because I was the manager of Dollar General.
Uh-huh.
I really didn't have the employees that I needed to really schedule them to work the hours that was needed, because they only allotted so many per mm-hmm. person. And it was hard to try to schedule them evenly out throughout the day. That meant I was in the store more often than anybody else.
That's so right, for sure. And you just really need to, you know, scheduling is very, could be very hard, could be, you know, you've got to be very careful with that. And especially if your sales aren't matching up with the amount of labor that you have, that could also cause problems. But the prime cost is the combination of food and beverage and labor all together. But making sure that you schedule properly. Estimate the number of guests at a certain time. Okay. Now, for example, a lot of like POS systems, point of sales systems, will have a kind of a graph or have a chart or have some sort of thing that you can print out that will show you all the times you're working, all the times that, from opening door to closing door, and it'll tell you how many people came in your door, what they bought, all of that sort of stuff. It will, and you can, with all that information there, right? A year from now, it can kind of estimate it'll calculate and estimate what the average, how many people are going to be maybe coming in the next day, right? Or the following day, a year from, this day or what have you. But it helps calculate, kind of estimate, how many guests are going to be coming in at a certain time. And sometimes you fail, you screw up, and you don't know that a play, a play is going to be letting out at this certain time. You didn't check on that, or you didn't know that there was some sort of something happening, and then there's lots of people coming out and wanting to be there. So, but estimating, very, very important. Look at the number of staff needed to serve a guest. You've got to look at your menu, right? You got to look at your menu. Do you have a menu where everybody's got to lift up a silver lid when people get the food and go, voila, or whatever else? No, I mean, if that's not the case, is that, do you need a bunch of waiters, bunch of waitresses? Do you need food runners? Do you need what does it take to serve a guest? How many people in the dining room does it take to serve it? And you've got one cook hour allots about, basically for a cooking aspect, one cook can cook for about 20 people. 20 guests equals about two cooked hours. For 10 guests, it's around four server hours. For one host, it's around 2 hours, or for about 20 guests, it's about 2 hours. And then you've got a total of eight employee hours are needed to cover 40 guests. So basically, 8 employee hours are needed to cover 40 guests. So that tells you you need 8 employee hours. So then you can kind of schedule, okay, this person I'm going to schedule right now, this person here, whatever else. But you need to be able to schedule those hours and be able to get the person so where you can not be shorthanded and not let it affect the customer, because the goal is not to let it affect the customer.
For that, do you typically forecast the days out, or you just like know your average?
You forecast it out, or usually I would forecast it out.
Okay, thank you.
Unless you're, you do have reservations, all of that sort of stuff. So, you'll estimate, you do the best you can when it comes to that. I determine what each hour equals in wages. Okay, so we want to determine that. So we went from, so here are the hours, right? Are the serving hours. Now we've got, you want to put it in a dollar amount. So the cook average wage is around $15. So that's times 2 hours. That's 30 hours right there. Or I'm sorry, not 30 hours, $30. My apologies. The server is wages around $5 times 4 hours. That's $20. The host average is around $8. So times that by 2 hours, that's $16. So that kind of gives you a dollar amount for those hours, give or take, an average. And this is on the average. So calculating the average check per guest, right? So, and that helps us with our labor, right? Because we need to figure out how much, what's our average guest check average, so where we can go, okay, so if we have 5 people in or 10 people, this is how much it's going to be, or whatever, but trying to find the check average. To find your projected labor percentage, the projected sales for your 40 guests is around $480. The projected labor dollars spent for 40 guests is around $60. And then divide the labor dollars by the sales, and you get the projected labor percent is around 13.75%. This falls in the normal range. The labor cost and no charges are, depending on any of the changes or charges, changes are adjusted accordingly at the very end. All right, so calculating, so we've got the projected labor dollars, that's $66, divided by the projected sales, that's $480, and projected labor percent is 0.138, okay? And that was what we just got right here. Okay, so now let's talk about, you know, scheduling. We talked a little bit about scheduling a few minutes ago, but scheduling is, like Marilyn was saying, very important because, and very hard, because if not, you know, it really can make you, as the manager, work harder, right? You know, because Marilyn was saying that she, you know, the scheduling practices at Dollar General were and so what they, so she spent more time because of the scheduling practices, how hard it was, she spent more time at work or there than other employees because of that. So scheduling is important. Scheduling is very difficult. Could be, you've just got to really make sure you don't have a great day. Love you. Let's see, just making sure you know, schedule the properly and you don't underschedule, you don't overschedule. I mean, it's such a balancing act, right? And then you've got people also taking you know, days off, right? So you also have to work on, okay, what days off people need. There are certain people that need certain days off. There are certain people that need, you know, this, that, the other. And you're trying to make it all kind of work out. You're never going to make everybody happy. So you need to make sure that you, you know, it is what it is, right? You just got to make it happen. And part of that puzzle is making sure that it all fits together and it all works together. And that's the unfortunate thing. Sometimes you screw up, you know, when you are making a schedule, there's going to be a schedule that's just going to be a shit show, right? You know, I mean, honestly, there's going to be a schedule that's going to be a bad schedule that you wrote and everybody's going to hate it and whatever else. It is what it is. Accept it and move on. I know it sucks. You know, and what I hate is hearing the bitching and moaning for the whole week or the whole month or whatever the schedule length is, you know, that's the, you know, but, you know, it is what it is. I tell them, you know, if you got a problem with it, you know, work with someone else. Well, work with your employee, you know, I would work with you, but also work with your fellow employees to help move around certain days if you need to move around. Most of the time when I have a schedule, I don't like to change it too often, but, you know, depending. You know, making sure you're, this is work jams. This is a study. I'm not going to, if you want to read about the study, that's fine. But the study, you know, the thing is, you need to really just make sure that you properly schedule your staff, you know, and you got to think about, would I schedule my kitchen staff the same time as my wait staff? Anybody?
I'm guessing no.
But no, but the answer is no, because what I don't want my wait staff sitting there for a couple of hours longer doing nothing, right? You know, I mean, I need my kitchen staff in there working, you know, going there early, right? So getting there early, prepping.
Earlier and later than the wait staff, right, Chef? Because they have
exactly
in clothes.
Yeah, exactly. And, you know, I mean, wait staff has, you know, closing duties and all of that sort of stuff, you know, and they have their stuff. But usually, you know, the front of the house, you know, people get there at least an hour or two after the kitchen folks, you know, so making sure you schedule the, you know, the right hours for the right times and everything else. You know, and if your busiest time is at 12 o'clock, make sure that you are staffed up properly at 12 o'clock. So you're not going to, it's not gonna, your labor is not going, the lack of labor is not going to affect your customers. Okay. That's the most important thing that, and we always run lean no matter what. In a kitchen, we're always shorthanded. And, you know, front staff, back staff, you name it, we're always running very, very lean. But the issue is, you know, when you're running lean and it affects your customers, that's when it's a problem. You've got to be very careful and not let it affect your customers. Because we've all had crappy service, right? We've all had crappy service when it comes to being shorthanded. People, when the front of the house people are shorthanded, or when the back of the house people are shorthanded, things are running slower, things take longer, all of that sort of stuff. So you got to be very careful with that. You want to streamline, you know, streamline everything, you know, just in general. You know, this word streamline, I would streamline everything. You want to make sure that everything's easy, everything's set in stone, everything's, you know, straight up and down. But for when you're communication with your employees, make it very easy, you know, or tell them, you know, that there's like communication apps like Slack or you know, other forms of kind of communication apps out there, are by email or by whatever else, but you need to be able to communicate with your staff and make sure that, you know, that they understand, you know, that it's important for that open communication, and that they, you know, people leave notes, they leave, you know, whatever else. Like, for example, front of the house needs to, or I'm sorry, the kitchen, you know, leaves notes for the PM people, or the AM people leave notes for PM, or vice versa. You know, what have you, just anything that makes sure that everybody's on the same page, everything's kind of working properly. Let's see, based off of 84% of employees who have, please. Okay. Someone read this one for me, please.
Streamline communication.
When managing
these varying forms of communication, matching employees' shift requests and available becomes less of a priority, and simply getting a set schedule becomes the most important to do. By opting for an integrated communication channel that all employees can access autonomously, employees can cultivate consistency and alleviate that superfluous stress secured from communicating across multiple channels.
Thank you. So again, communication, right? I can't stress it enough. However you can communicate, by notes, by emails, by text, by whatever it is, just making sure you communicate properly and effectively. And we talked about effective communication as well, and how to effectively communicate to employees. Let's see. Same thing about the study. We've kind of talked all about this already. So something that I want y'all to make sure that you know is when you're making schedules, you want to try your best to at least do 2 weeks out. Because your employees want to, they have a life. They need to schedule things, right? You know, it's very important to try to make sure everybody, you know, the schedules are written for at least a week, you know, I would say at least 2 weeks, you know, just because it gets people to know what they're doing, right? You're gonna have less people calling out or having issues, because if you do it a little further out, like 2 weeks, you have people that can schedule doctor's appointments around their work. If you do it 1 week out, you know, sometimes you can't schedule and you have to get someone to change your schedule or whatever else. So if you do 2 weeks out or longer, you have a better opportunity of not having to change the schedule as often because of that. And you know, making sure that you kind of deal with call outs and sick days and all of that. And you really have to watch those, because if someone doesn't, like for example, for me, let's say I get sick or something and I've got to do a sick day, I got to log on to a website and do a sick day through that. And then you need to make sure that you have, however the procedures are on calling out or getting a sick day, you need to have that written in stone so where everybody understands that, and that you maybe can't call out, you can't, you know, 5 minutes before your shift starts, you can't, you know, call, you gotta, at least you have to call 30 minutes before, an hour before, whatever your, you know, parameters are in that restaurant or whatever else, you know, that's y'all's decision. But making sure that you have things written in stone, that, because if not, you're gonna have people calling up 5 minutes before their shift starts and saying, "Hey, I'm gonna be late. I'm not gonna be able to come in." Well, 5 minutes before their shift starts is not gonna be helpful. It's not gonna be able to. You're not gonna have a good lead time to fix the problem. So making sure that you have a good lead time. Let's see. You know, let's see, oops. Once the schedule is posted, make sure that the team, you know, the team or crew, your crew honors it, right? You know, because once it's up and it's posted, you know, you know, that's what it is. And a lot of times if there needs to be a little change, that's fine, I might change it. But a lot of times I'll say, Okay, work it out amongst yourselves, right? You know, like for example, if a chef, instead of me putting in a sick day, I can say, hey, or if I need to go to the doctor or take a personal day, I can say, hey, Marilyn, can you work for me today? And I'll work for you tomorrow. And we just kind of trade shifts, as long as it's communicated and it's communicated to the manager prior to that service, prior to the change, for sure, then I'm okay with it. But it needs to, you need that approval, you need that, you need to make sure that you get that blessing before you do anything else. Let's watch these two videos on calculating.
We're putting together a crew.
I'm in.
Boss.com, and today we're going to talk about labor cost. The last few posts I've put up have been a little fluffy, less hard skill, more kind of theoretical and restaurant management and all that mumbo jumbo. And actually, if you get to know me a little bit, as much as I love that style and I think those are so important, I am very, very much a numbers guy. You can't operate a profitable restaurant unless you know where your dollars are going, unless you know where your pennies are going. You cannot operate a profitable restaurant. However, I also know that in order to move your needle, I mean, and to move it quick and fast, there are some other things that we need to talk about in your restaurant, which are really why the chains are kicking our butts out there sometimes. So today's different though. Today is gonna be numbers. Today is gonna be labor cost. If you're not already familiar with my thoughts on prime cost and how important prime cost is for your restaurant, please go ahead and have a look around my website. Somewhere on here, I have it featured. I have a three-part series that's titled Why Food Cost Isn't the Most Important Number in Your Restaurant, something like that. I change the title once in a while, but basically it's a prime cost program. And I talk about why I only care about prime cost in your restaurant. However, labor cost is one of those components. So we're gonna just quickly today talk about labor in your restaurant and a management theory that you can't expect what you don't inspect. You can't expect what it is that you don't inspect. So today we're gonna talk about a very, very quick way to inspect your labor. If you're not currently using any kind of daily labor tracking system, program, spreadsheet, whatever it is, this is where I want you to start. It's extraordinarily simple. There is a lot missing from here. But if you're not even tracking labor on a daily basis, start with this. Build a very simple Excel spreadsheet. Monday through Sunday, total, front of the house, back of the house. You might have another category. Maybe you want bar here. Maybe you have bar and catering. You know your restaurant better than I do. But just for simplicity, front of the house, back of the house. Now, let's assume that on Monday, you ran $500 in front of the house labor and $500 in back of the house labor for $1,000. Okay, now, depending on what your labor cost goals are, and you may not even have labor cost goals at this point, and that's fine. If you don't, go ahead and shoot me an email. Let's talk about that a little bit or do a little bit more research. Again, look at my prime cost video because it's gonna be really important. But here's the thing to keep in mind. Now you know, you did $1,000 in labor today, and you'd probably put a sales category or something here. But let's assume you did 3,000 in sales that day. Quick math means you're running a 33% labor cost. That may be great. I don't know. That may be horrible for you. I don't know. I get so many questions. Is this a good labor cost? Is this a good labor cost? Is this a good food cost? Watch that training series. I'll talk about all that. I don't know. But that's the reality. And that's not actually including your taxes and your insurance and your benefits and all that. And we'll get to all that later. I told you this is very simple. I just want you to start tracking it. We can get into more details later. The point is though, let's assume 33% is high for you. If you wait till your month is over, if you wait till your week is over, but if you wait till your month is over, there's nothing you can do now. You're in reaction mode. You're not proactively running your business. You're reacting to it. So here's what you could do. Maybe that's a bit high for you. Well, you better call someone off tomorrow, unless you're scheduled to do more business tomorrow. But this way, if you're tracking labor on a daily basis, when you start coming into your busy Friday, Saturday, Sunday, then you can start making adjustments throughout the week to make sure that you hit whatever your goal is. I don't know what your goal is, but make sure that you are inspecting labor daily and make sure that you're active, that you're calling people off, that you're calling people in, that you're running where you need to be. You can't do anything about it later, and it may not seem like a lot, but let me tell you, 50, 60, 100 bucks a day in labor, 20 or 30 bucks a day in labor. Let's take $10 a day in labor. If you could shave $10 a day in labor, that's $3,650 at the end of the year. That's a trip to Hawaii. That is a trip to Hawaii. Is it worth the 10 minutes a day so that way you can go to Hawaii next year? Save $20 a day on labor. That's a trip for you and your spouse to Hawaii. Save 50, you're taking the whole family to Hawaii and all you had to do was save $50 a day. I can't tell you guys how important this is. Track your numbers on a daily basis, know where you're at. Even if you don't know what to do with them yet, contact me, we can figure that out. But start tracking them. Simple, that's fine. I know there's stuff missing here. Sorry, I know this went a little long. Just wanted to stress to you how important it is. Again, this is Ryan.
All right, one more.
In this short training video, I'm going to show you a way to raise the level of accountability in your restaurant, quite literally, beginning tomorrow. From now on, whenever someone on your team fails to adequately complete or follow through on a commitment or responsibility, I want you to stop asking for excuses or reasons. If you're having an issue with a lack of accountability, this could be a big part of it. See if this rings true. You say to someone, "Did you get the walk-in cleaned or the schedule completed?" And they say, "No, I didn't." Then you ask them why or why not. Then they give you an excuse or reason, which, by the way, you just asked for. Then once they give you their excuse or reason, you actually give them a paycheck. Think about what you've just done. You have just paid for their excuse and not for the task or job that was their responsibility to get done. And when you give them their paycheck, you've just set yourself up for more excuses down the road. Now, some people claim that there's a difference between an excuse and a reason, but I've heard it said that the only difference between an excuse and a reason is the spelling. Just think about it. Whether they give you an excuse or a reason, what they're actually saying is, "I have a legitimate reason for not doing my job." Let me ask you this. What legitimate reason or excuse will that same employee accept for not having a full and on-time paycheck? You know the answer to that, none. So here's what you can do. Stop giving or accepting excuses for non-accountability. I'm sure you've noticed that people tend to treat us the way we allow them to treat us, and this is especially true when it comes to people that we manage. If you buy excuses or reasons for non-accountability, your people will keep giving them. When you stop asking for and accepting their excuses and reasons, they will stop giving them. So stop asking why or why not if they tell you that they didn't do their job. Instead, do the following. You ask your chef, "Did you update the recipe manual with the new specials?" And he says no. You ask the following three questions. 1, what's your plan to get it done? And get an action plan, not an excuse. Then ask, when will you do that? Get a reasonable time or date for the action. And here's the last step. You pause, look them in the eyes, and say, "Can I count on you for that?" Here's an example. You ask, "Did you complete the maintenance checklist for the month?" And they say, "No, I didn't." You say, "What's your next step to get it done?" They say, "Can I tell you why I didn't get it done?" You say, "No. What is your plan to get it done?" Don't move on until you get a specific plan or action step. Then you ask, "When will you do that?" or "When will you get that done?" and get a specific time and date. Then pause and ask, "Can I count on you for that?" So, from now on, when someone misses on a commitment or responsibility, do not ask them why it didn't get done. Instead, ask the three questions. 1, what's your plan or next step to get it done? And then get an action step, not an excuse. 2, when will you do that? Get a reasonable time and date for the action. And three, can I count on you for that? Start doing this today and you'll quickly begin to get a lot fewer excuses and you'll see a lot more work getting done the right way and on time. Accountability is the glue that ties intention and commitment to results. And in a restaurant where you're counting on so many people to do so many things the right way, on time, accountability is absolutely crucial. If you want a higher level of accountability in your restaurant, we have a comprehensive course entitled Building a Culture of Accountability in the Learning System. Your entire management.
All right, so I think that helps out with when you deal with employees and employees not doing their job correctly and on time and any excuse. I think that right there helps out with a lot of the excuses because I hate excuses. I hate having to deal with that, so making sure that I don't hear excuses because that the hearing excuses kind of bothers me, you know, bugs me or whatever else. So, you know, that's kind of one of those things of, okay, well, if I change my way I approach my employees, I won't get those excuses, right? And the way I communicate with them. So learning how to communicate properly is very important. And making sure you have those three ways of kind of dealing with those, you know, when you hear excuses or whatever else, it kind of shuts the person down a little bit. All right, so with that being said, that ends our little bit for today. And again, every day, you know, we get out at least a couple hours early the past, you know, week. So I need to make sure that you keep up with your project and make sure you get that project done. All of it, I would say, I want no later than Monday morning before class, because I'm going to spend Monday morning a little bit going through everybody's where I'm going to we'll go through each individual person's, or I'm going to try. So make sure you send that to me. Questions, problems, concerns, issues for today. We're almost, I mean, next Thursday is our last. We've got 1 week left. This next Thursday is your last day of class. So any questions, problems, concerns? Yes, no, maybe so. We good?
For the presentations, would we be able to present on Wednesday instead of Thursday?
Yeah, I can put you down for Wednesday.
Just since because of the National Guard thing I told you about before.
Yeah, I totally forgot about it. So thank you.
No problem, Chef.
All right. Okay. So remind me on Monday when that you're going to do it on Wednesday.
Yes, Chef.
Any other problems, questions, issues? We good?
Hey, Chef, were you able to get that discussion?
Yeah, I'm still working on that discussion. I don't know how. I'm still trying to figure it out. I don't know. There's something that's not allowing me to allow, or some setting. So I'm trying to mess with the setting. So I'm working on it. I'll let y'all know when I get it fixed. Cool. All right, then, y'all have a good day. I will be looking at your projects. If you send them to me, I will respond to it, today while I'm kind of going through all your projects. Other than that, have a great day. Be safe.
Thanks, Chef.
Have a good one.
You as well.